गुड मॉर्निंग एवरी वन, आई राधिका फुलझेले वेलकम्स यू ऑल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ शाह एंड एंकर कच्ची इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज मुंबई इंडिया. वी एट साकेक रिसर्च सेल विल टेक दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू थैंक ईच एंड एवरी वन ऑफ यू प्रेजेंट हियर टूडे फॉर दिस हाइब्रिड वेबिनार सीरीज इनोवेटिव एंड इमर्जिंग टेक्नोलॉजी इन द फील्ड ऑफ रिसर्च इन कोलैबोरेशन विथ ऑल अवर पार्टनर्स. Today, our speaker, Ms. Anam Gwalior, is going to tell us about the role of emotions in consumer behavior. Our speaker, Ms. Anam Gwalior, is consultant at Ernst & Young LLP. She works as a content writer at College Pond. She has done master's in applied psychology from Bharatiya University. Before handing over to our speaker, I would like to make a note to all my attendees that if you have any queries or you want to ask any question to our speaker throughout the session, you can ask it via Q&A chat box. Now I hand over the session to our speaker. Ma'am, can you share your screen?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. So thank you, ma'am, for such a kind introduction, and welcome all of you to this session. Thanks for taking the time to join this session. And I hope whatever I present today proves fruitful to you in your journey ahead. And while a lot of details were presented about me, there's also one thing that I would like to mention, that I am not an expert and I'm a learner, because human beings are inherently complicated. And trying to understand my parents, my siblings, is itself a very big task. Forget trying to get to know everything about us as a consumer. But nonetheless, science is learning, and we are all learning, and we are all trying to find out how we can become better consumers and how AdWords can become better providers. So let's start discussing and having a deep dive into this whole world of emotions, where a lot of what we do and a lot of decisions that we take are inherently controlled by our emotions. And talking about control, coronavirus has controlled a lot of our activities, and we inherently miss what we used to do previously, like, you know, meeting our friends and a lot of other stuff. And one thing that I miss the most is, yes, I do miss meeting my friends, but I'm also missing the sumptuous meal that I used to get in weddings. So look at their plates. I'm sorry for doing this to you. So let me, you know, quickly take you back to those old golden days where we used to all dress up and attend weddings and have sumptuous meal. So if you remember, a typical Indian wedding setup looks something like this. We have the center stage, which is allocated for the couple. The seating arrangement besides that is for family, close friends, and those kids who are running around at the stage and wait for the couple to go to have dinner so that, you know, they can sit on their seats and also pluck the roses and carnations behind. Then the first few rows are booked for the close relatives, people who are special again. And the rest of the seating arrangement is for the guests. Now, while the rational purpose behind this seating arrangement and all the chairs over here remains the same, which is for people to sit and make them feel comfortable, there is a lot more that meets the eye. If we clearly notice and try to understand, each chair and each seating type in this arrangement signifies the importance of the person during the event. And it is even mentally difficult for us to reverse this seating arrangement. Because wait a minute, the couple is supposed to be the most special entity for the session. It is their day. They need to feel special. They need to feel prestigious. They need to feel like the center of attention. And so is their chair. And along with that feeling, there is a behavior that comes along with it. So a couple has to behave in a certain way. There is a posture they need to maintain. There's a kind of words that they need to use. So yes, there is a lot more that is taken into consideration while the chair for a wedding is selected. And while this struck me that subconsciously we do take a lot of things into account based on what we will feel when we use that particular commodity, I was recently watching a series, Panchayat. It's a Hindi Amazon Prime web series. And there was one particular episode in that called Chakke Wali Kursi, which means chairs or wheels. And there were few particular scenes in that series which really struck my attention, and I'll play that for you.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, you are not audible.
Is my video not visible?
Yeah, it is. Video is working. I think audio is not working.
Okay, I'll just play again. I'm just trying to play it. Is it audible now?
No. I think you must have select the system audio option before share the video.
The system audio option? Just check.
Ma'am, your internet is also means lagging.
Is it lagging?
Yeah.
Okay. One second. I'll just try to. So I need to select custom setup for my audio.
During share option there mm-hmm. is a option in a left hand side topmost, include system audio.
I'll just do one thing. Okay. Please tell me if you can hear it now.
Yeah, it's working now.
I'm
but audio is very small. Means volume is too small.
I'm just playing it again. Apologies for the.
If you have a separate video file that you can share, including the system audio.
Sorry?
If you have a different media file directly, you can play and include the system audio.
Okay, I'll do that. Just let me know if that is fine.
Okay.
It's fine.
Ma'am, your internet is also lagging actually. Ma'am, I recommend you to turn off the video, your webcam.
Yeah, I'll just do that. One second. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Does it seem better now?
Yes.
Yeah, so I'm playing the video.
Yeah, it's audible. Ma'am, it's still not audible.
Okay, I think we'll let go of the video. I think we'll let go of the video. I'll just continue.
Yes, ma'am, yes.
Okay. So apologies for the video trouble, but if I have to just summarize what was there in the video, this episode was primarily directed to mentioning how something like a chair with just a modified version of a normal chair can invoke a lot of feelings within us. So if you must have seen, there was this feeling of prestige, power, responsibility, and status associated with just slight modification in the chair that was done. And this is just not observed with a chair. It's just not observed about a chair. While a lot of us feel that the purchases that we make or the ideas that we purchase or the thoughts that we accept have a lot to do with the rationale behind it, it's actually observed that most of our decisions are guided by our emotions. So right from the shampoo that you would like to purchase to the YouTube channel that you follow or the leaders that we select or the prestigious institute that you would like to get into is mostly guided by our emotions. And neuromarketing is one field which is extensively trying to research and understand how better can adverts tap onto this area of humans wherein these emotions can ignite the correct output that they require and they achieve phenomenal growth for themselves. And on similar lines, just to try to understand how brand loyalty works, I'll share with you an example of a study that was done for iPhone 5. So when iPhone 5 was launched, there was an experiment that was conducted on 10 male and females between the age of 18 and 25. And what they did was they were trying to firstly understand how addictive the iPhone can be. And while yes, there was no doubt that yes, it was addictive, but the one striking thing that they observed was that the sound of the iPhone ignited a lot of activity in the area of the brain called the insular cortex. And that area is believed to be responsible for our emotional feelings, including maternal and romantic love. So the subjects responded to the tone of the iPhone in the similar way as they would respond to their spouses or their family members. So you literally love your phones and you're not just addicted to them. So that is that's what the research concluded finally. And talking about romantic love and maternal love, there has been one object where we have been very much associating with love and commitment. Any guesses? Yes. Diamonds are a girl's best friend. It's a sign of commitment. If he does not propose you with a diamond ring, he is not into you. Sounds familiar, right? And while a lot of us have a lot of joyous emotions associated with the diamond, a lot of craving associated with the diamond and feelings of prestige, the actual truth behind the whole this whole concept of diamonds being so important is not very joyous. And let me take you to this very famous, the De Beers diamond scam. So it all started in the 1870s, where a huge deposit of diamond mines and diamonds were found in South Africa. And prior to that, diamonds were only mined in South America and India. So because of this, select few people had access to diamonds, mostly the monarchy and the royalty. And wearing diamonds, you know, in terms of engagement rings, etc., was not a tradition until then. And so when it was found that there are these diamond deposits that have been found in South Africa, that also a huge one, there was an British imperialist called Cecil Rhodes. He started buying property in those areas, started buying all the property of those diamond deposits, including a farm that was owned by two brothers named the De Beers. And soon, even small diamond mine owners started collaborating with them, and they formed a huge consortium called the De Beers, a Consolidated Mines Company, and they started controlling all the diamond supply of South Africa. Now, there was a problem. Diamond was about to flood the market. And if it was about to flood the market, the costs were about to reduce. But the cost for mining them was not being affected, right? They were paying the same amount. So they had to do something about it. So what they did is they controlled the diamond supply. So Cecil Rhodes controlled the diamond supply. He created intermediaries to buy the uncut diamonds from the De Beers company, sent them on to cutters and polishers, and from there to the retail jewelers to sell. And what they also did along with this was they set the diamond rates in the market for all the diamond traders, irrespective of whether they were associated with them or not. Now, this is how they handled the supply. What about the demand? Because at that time, after some years, there was a Great Depression that happened, and diamond, considering it was a luxury, not a lot of people could afford it. And they had to increase the demand for diamond somehow. So ta-da, comes the most classic and iconic marketing strategy ever. They hired a New York ad agency, N.W. Ayer, and their copywriter, Mary Frances Garrettie, assigned diamonds an emotional value, since there was no physical value to them at that time, and invented the tagline, "A diamond is forever." It became the greatest slogan of the century, and till date is used as an example in this advertising field. I just look at this advertisement. They are literally telling you that it is going to cost your 2 months' salary to purchase this small diamond. So this 4C system was also invented by them, which made sure that if even the diamond is small, this whole quality process keeps the price intact. And suddenly, when this whole tagline came up, there was this whole rush in the market. A lot of brides started wanting to wear diamonds. Until date, we all are in awe of this gem. But the one dark truth that we are not aware of is the entire corruption process that runs behind this diamond trade, wherein a lot of people and a lot of lives are taken in the mines, and a lot of exploitation is done. And this, though is being regulated to a great extent now, but still the dark truth behind that still is prevalent. And so when I got to learn about this whole concept, my first reaction was, well played. So now, is it just the corporates that took advantage of the fact that emotions play a lot of role in our decision making? Or was it the others too? Let's find out. Let's visit one of the most animated times of the century, the World War I. Now, this was a time where academia had started entering the field of advertisement and trying to understand the relationship between emotions and the decision making of a consumer. At that time, a lot of publication houses also started rigorously adapting these techniques, and their sales saw an increase of about 450%. And that is when the politicians felt that why not utilize this concept to our ideas as well. And the one fine example of how they utilized this concept was the very famous propaganda by the British, and to a lot of extent the American governments during the World War I. So what happened was that they wanted the war to go on somehow, and they wanted to hit the right chord with the people to you know, help them come on board, and they wanted their support and they wanted them to agree for the war to continue. And so they spread a propaganda. They said that the Germans were actually making soap out of enemy soldiers. So if I have to explain it in detail, they meant that the Germans were using the cops to actually take fat out of them and turn them into soaps. And this ignited a feeling of disgust and anger in the minds of people that they do not want such a gruesome and heinous country to win. And they continued to agree for the battle. And on similar lines, a plethora of propaganda news was spread at that time so that they could get people on board. And also they came up with these posters that was so emotionally charging that people were very much aroused, and they were angered by looking at those, because they wanted to be a part of the revolution. They wanted to be a part of the military. And this is how they justified their reasoning for continuing with the battle. Now imagine, this was the magnitude of outcome governments and corporates achieved by simply tapping onto the emotions of the people in the initial phases when researchers were trying to connect emotions to our decision making. Fast track to our world, our digitally data-driven connected world, where every activity that I do, where my likes, my interests, my political interests, my entertainment interests, my purchasing behavior, my different patterns of my decision making are being tracked. And my thoughts and feelings are being converted to hard data, which is being fed to a system which is trying to predict what my future behavior is going to be, what my purchase pattern is going to be. Different methods are being researched and come up with to make me loyal to a particular brand. And the finest examples we've seen in history is of those brands like Coca-Cola and Pepsi. While we all know that they have a lot of sugar content and they can cause a lot of illnesses like diabetes, etc., but they do not advertise their brands on their features or their products ingredients. They advertise their brand on a different level altogether. They associate the brand with the feelings of youth. So when you see a Pepsi advertisement, you can relate it to your college days, your youth, feeling of being energetic and innovative. When you talk about Coca-Cola, there's this happiness quotient associated with it. And that's how it has branded itself. When you talk about Nike hardly will talk about the product features. What it will talk about is how they revere sports people, how they want the sportsmanship to be promoted, how they are talking about comfort. This is the areas that they work upon. When you talk about Apple, they will not talk about the features of Apple products. What they'll talk about is how they make you feel like a part of a particular community. They will tell you how you are exclusive, how you belong to a particular tribe. And so these are the areas that they tap onto. So we do not buy these products based on their features most of the times, but we buy them because they make us feel like we are one amongst them. They make us feel that we have a status attached to us. And researchers are constantly trying to make themselves better and better in terms of how they can tap onto these things. And this one field that has emerged in the past few years, which is neuromarketing. And a lot of tools are being utilized in this field to really understand our behavior and make the adverts and the other producers improve their marketing strategies. So let's have a look at this. So the primary purpose of neuromarketing tools, if I have to explain in simple words, is to find the buy button in our brains. So we all have that buy button. That's what they want to try to tap into. And a lot of tools are being utilized. I'm going to focus primarily on six tools in the session. The first is the fMRI. Now, this is similar to the MRI that we are all familiar with. But the one difference that this tool has is that it will also give you real-time images of the blood flow and the activity associated in a particular area of the brain when the subject is being subjected to a stimuli. Then we have this EEG. So this will have, you have those metallic plates that are being placed, and you have that, and they record the electric signals on the scalp from the neurons to check a neural activity. Then we have these eye tracking gaze. So this eye tracking gaze will actually try to understand where my attention is focused on the most, when I'm reading a particular text, when I'm looking at a poster, where do I look first, and for how long do I look at a particular area, and in a particular area in an advertisement. The next is the eye tracking pupillometry. What this will test is how engaged I am to a particular advertisement, and what are the kind of feelings that that advertisement is actually invoking in me, whether I am having positive feelings, whether I'm having negative feelings, how engaged I am to that particular poster or the advert. Next is the biometrics. Now, while I was actually taking up sessions on NLP and REBT, now these are therapy courses, the one thing that we were taught was that words can lie, but the body cannot. So if I'm afraid, my heartbeat will race, I'll perspire, and a lot of other things will happen along with that. So my emotion is just not about my feelings, but also the body processes that go along with it. So this is the biometric tool that is being used. So biometric will measure the skin's conductance, the heart rate, and respiration. So if they subject me to a stimuli, they will check how my body is reacting to it, which helps them understand how effective their product is. And the next is facial coding. Again, expressions and facial expressions will tell everything over what it's non-verbal communication. So even if I might not say this is yuck, my expressions will say those things. This is what they try to map. And trying to get into all these tools, they have all come up with amazing marketing strategies. And the few strategies that we're all familiar with, let's have a look at those. We visit housing.com, we visit amazon.com and a lot of other sites, and we don't want to miss out on the good deals, right? So if you see in high demand, only two rooms left on a site, these kind of tricks that marketers actually utilize is called the FOMO marketing, which is the fear of missing out. We don't want to miss out on anything, right? And how well will we understand? Who can better understand this than the people of this era, especially the coronavirus period era, where we have to, you know, log in at 9 a.m. so that the big basket does, the availability of products does not run out on big basket. These are the basic emotions. We don't want to miss out on things. We don't want to be the loser. We don't want to have a loss. And this is the exact feeling that they tap into. So though they might be having a lot of rooms at the back end, but they will try to show you that there are only two rooms left. So that they don't miss out on you, and you don't miss out. You don't supposedly miss out on the deal. This is FOMO marketing. And the next is a very famous and quite famously observed marketing technique, which is the testimonials marketing. So if I am recommended a series, or if I am recommended a product by anybody, or even on the web or from my friend circle, I will give it a shot. So this is the testimonial marketing. The next is competition. So what happens in this case is, they'll tell you that this particular room or this particular property is being watched by a lot of people, and if you don't want to miss out, so that you're a lot of people eyeing on this, but I should just get into it. So this is the next part of it. And the ones that we also see are the flash sales. So only 3 days left, 50% off on this, etc. So these are all the typically used sales techniques and practices where people show you what they want to show you. So a lot of the reality that we see is actually not the reality, it is what people want to show us. And this brings me to a very important question. While I have discussed a lot about what corporates and governments and media, etc., showcase in front of us and what they actually do to make a fortune for themselves, is it just they who do this? Are we always on the other side of the spectrum? Are we always the ones who are the consumers? Not really. According to evolution, reproduction is one of the main ambitions of life. And we're all born advertisers. We all advertise ourselves. We all want to show we are the best, including the animals, including the mating season. They want to show that they are the best, they're the perfect fit. The survival of the fittest, if we call it. It is in advertising ourselves is ingrained in us. And it's what we accept as consumers that matters the most. So for example, forget the advertisers and the huge corporations. Let's talk about us. So many a times we post stuff on the social media. We post stuff on our normal communication and in front of other people. We show them the stuff that we only want to show them. And a lot of times we also buy the thoughts and ideas of everybody according to what we see. We hardly try to contemplate the actual realities or the facts behind what is being told to us. We get affected by it. We get mentally unbalanced by it. We start questioning ourselves. We start questioning our capabilities. And that's how this whole process of being a troubled consumer begins. Because ideally, everybody is doing what they want to do, including us. But as consumers, maybe we are falling short of what we should do. Because ultimately, it is us who is giving them the data. It is us who is showing them the thoughts and the feelings that we go through when we shop for a particular thing. And this is the data that they are using to derive their insights. But I feel it's high time now is to understand that how can I best operate as a consumer? What are the right questions I can ask myself when I'm going to purchase a thought or an idea? What is the rationale I want to question myself with when I hear a speech? Because right now when you see, it's not just in the form of visuals or in the form of the content available on a website or an advertisement that branding is done. It's also about the speech. So if you see, a lot of research is done in terms of what are the right kind of words you use to persuade people. And during these times, we're also subjected to a lot of words that we can recall very easily. So what do you think? How are these coming out? They are coming out of a lot of research, a lot of study done to try to understand what words will strike the right chord with us, as it was done during World War I. What are the right kind of words that will, you know, make us feel like, come on, you got to go, you got to do this. And whether they're right or wrong is out of the scope of this discussion. What is in scope of the discussion is to try to understand how we can be better consumers. And to conclude this, I would like to leave all of you with three questions that I feel we must as consumers ask ourselves before we accept any idea, any thought, or any product and imbibe it in our lives. The first question I feel we should ask ourselves is, do I have all the relevant knowledge on this? Am I impulsively buying this product because it is just giving me instant gratification? Am I purchasing this thought? Am I buying this idea because this is just giving me instant gratification, or it looks flattery, it looks glittery? Or I know the rationale behind this. I know the backstory. I understand this product. I can reason with myself to purchase this. I can reason with myself to buy this idea and imbibe it in my life. The second is this going to be useful in the next 6 months? Is this thought that I am thinking, is this product that I'm buying, or is this idea that I'm accepting going to be useful in the long term? 6 months, 1 year, whatever time limit is essential based on the product. Am I doing this questioning with myself enough? And the last is, am I purchasing this for a genuine need or cultural pressure? Am I buying this because I feel that I must buy this? Am I buying that particular product because it says that I am inadequate, and using this I will feel better about myself, or I'll be a success if I utilize this? We are well aware of these kind of products that roam around the market, where their actual task is to make us feel inadequate, and once we use them we will feel on top of the world, or we will be a success. And the positioning is done in such a way that they tap onto those feelings, and lo, we have satisfied ourselves at the shop, purchasing it and feeling, yes, I'm going to get better with this. But sadly, we do not get better. The cycle starts, and this process of you know, going on for the next and the next and the next thing continues till we are left miserable. So we need to ask ourselves, am I buying this because I genuinely need this and I feel good about this, or am I doing it under some kind of pressure, cultural pressure that has been established, and just because I feel this will define me because others feel so. And along with all of these questions, there is one beautiful entity that we have been provided, which is gut. So at times you feel certain things are too good to be true, and when you feel that, I think you should just give it a thought and accept, yes, it might be too good to be true, or it might not be good, because gut, or sixth sense, or as you call it, is a very strong entity in us, and it really guides us to a lot of extent. So with this, I conclude my talk, and I would like to make the floor open for any questions that you may have, and let's discuss for the rest of the time.
Yes, ma'am, we have a question. May I ask?
Yeah, sure.
How would you feel if you could no longer use this product?
How would you feel if you would no longer use this product?
Yes.
Okay. So how would I feel if I would no longer use this product? Now, there is a lot of question I need to ask myself before that, which is, why am I using this product? So it is said that if your why is clear, a lot of other things go in line. So if I ask myself, why am I using this product? So if I am using this phone, okay, because I need to call people, I need to stay in touch with people, and I have an answer to this. Now, what kind of product I'm using is another question. So if I'm using an expensive product, I need to ask myself, why am I using this product? And will I be well off without this product? So if I will be well off this product, this is where my motivation comes into picture. This is where my determination comes into picture, and the belief system that I have set for myself comes into picture. So if I have my answers clear, if I am ready to face the consequences because I want a desired outcome, then I think I will feel better if I don't use that product, if my answers and my determination with myself is clear. I hope that answers the question.
Yes, ma'am. Next question. Yeah. What other solutions have you considered if you want to launch old product?
If I want to launch old product, okay. So what about it talks about, this is primarily of this has to do with what kind of strategy or what kind of message I want to promote while I'm launching that product. So if I talk about some old quality or some, let's talk about a movie or a concept or a series. So if this movie is about some old concepts, if it's not the usual short running movies these days, if it's a lengthy movie, is also a product according to me. How am I going to picturize it in front of me? What is the one pain point that I claim I will address with this movie? What new will I offer to the people? Though the concept is old, but what is a new thing, and what is the untapped and untouched thing that I will offer to the people through this particular product of mine? And what is the one important need that I'm solving for them? And how am I presenting it to them? So a lot of what you do, a lot of how you present things matters. So if you see, until today, Maggie is on all our lips, right? Maggie, right? Whoa. It's not because Maggie talks about the product. It is how it has projected the product. So while a lot of products have come after Maggie, and they keep continuing, and they continue to come, the products of a particular Reliance Mart has its own noodle that it has come up with. How is Maggie reinventing them itself, though being an old product? So what they do is they tap onto certain emotions that we have. For example, if you must have seen, there was this Maggie mom concept that they came up with. So what you do during this time is you tap onto this feeling of a mother being a very good person who works, she can handle this, she can handle that, etc., etc. Nostalgia, children coming from their hostels after a lot of time, and you see that and you relate it to yourself, like, oh, if I eat this, it will invoke nostalgia in me. If I eat this, it will make me feel good. So this is how you can come up with and picturize old products by understanding what kind of emotion you want to ignite in people and what is the pain point that you claim that you want to address. Hope that answers the question.
Yes, ma'am. Next question. What is your opinion on Jio Giga Fiber product? How this product will get success on emotional marketing?
I don't know which techie has joined this session. So there are certain rules which are standard in terms of emotional marketing. One rule is Make in India. There is this new campaign that is going on, right? Local to global, or Make in India, or Startup India. A lot of these ideas are going on. And there's one point that I will also try to mention in this is, when you think of Jio, you think of India. When you think of Jio, you think of nationalism. And my friends, nationalism is the biggest seller in the market today. So if you have a feeling of nationalism associated with the brand, your first purpose is solved. That is, you are selling the product for sure. But how will you sustain the audience? How will you sustain your buyers? Is with the quality that you will offer them. So if I am being asked that in terms of emotional marketing, how this will do, if nationalism is associated with it, it will do very well. If this is the premise of its promotion, then yes, it is set out to be a winner. But for how long it will sustain will definitely have a lot to do with what it offers to its people. Hope that answers the question.
Yes. Ma'am, last question. Give example of products that get success on emotional marketing.
Oh, I think I have covered a lot of examples on products that have done well because of emotional marketing. And I'll share some more examples on similar lines. So I spoke about beverages like Coca-Cola and Pepsi. You see a lot of products now called, there was this product that I had that I saw, Kajaria Tiles. Before that, I was not aware of what Kajaria Tiles was. But when I saw Akshay Kumar's ad and the nationalism that was associated with Kajaria Tiles, I don't know whether I'm going to have Kajaria Tiles at home tomorrow, but I definitely can recall Kajaria Tiles now. On the other hand, if I think of a lot of speeches, if I think of Obama's speech or the speeches of any of the leaders which have a lot of emotions attached to them, a lot of emotions telling me how I am a good citizen, or what I as a citizen want to do for my country, and a lot of other things, a lot of pathos in the speech, I will recall it for sure. And to some extent, I feel that this idea, this product talks about me. This idea talks about me. This is one thing. If you all remember Raymond's, the complete man, it is not talking about the quality of the cloth used for Raymond. It is telling you, you are a complete man if you use Raymond. So this is one more example if we have to think of in terms of emotional marketing. So it makes a man feel complete. And so that's about it. You'll find countless examples in history for emotional marketing. Hope that answers.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for telling us that emotions plays a vital role in decision making.
Thank you, everyone, for joining. Yeah.
This is a small token of appreciation on behalf of Sakik Research Sale for you, ma'am. Please accept it with our sincere thanks.
Thank you, thank you, thank you, everyone. Thanks for joining.
Thank you, ma'am.